On This Week in Enterprise Tech, infrastructure as a service, the new flavors of virtualization, and stuff you need to take on your summer vacation. It's Wyatt on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 144, recorded June 5th, 2015, or June 12th, 2015. Something, something as a service. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 100-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. Welcome to Twyatt This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. And of course, I'm guiding you along with my co-host, starting with Mr. Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Brian, you are looking, you're looking quite cool. I hope it's cooling off in Hawaii.
It's a fan.
Oh, okay. Yes, the marvels of technology. But other than temperature, I hope things are well for the geek in paradise.
So far, just playing data wrangling issues with all that data coming off Maui.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, we talked about the SmartNet last week. Hopefully we get to get an update at some point in the near future. Now, a man who always gives us his updates, Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, welcome back to Twyatt. It's so good to see you.
Padre, it's great to be here. You know, it just wouldn't be Friday without Twyatt.
Well, Lou Maresca, a good friend of the show, is going to be joining us just in a bit. But first, we thought we should probably run through the Enterprise blips. This first one comes to us from space. Now, when something goes wrong in your colo, you're probably set up for out-of-band management so that you can get back into your stricken gear. Barring that, you'll need a good pair of remote hands to get your box communicating. Of course, if your box is in space, orbiting 500 miles above the planet, your management choices are a bit more limited. That's what's happening to LightSail A, a solar sail demonstrator spacecraft launched on May 20th of this year by the Planetary Society. The mission started well, with LightSail sending back 140 packets of data, but over the Memorial Day weekend, the little spacecraft that could went silent. As far as they can tell, the spacecraft is suffering from a software bug in the telemetry system. They're hoping that a high-energy particle will strike the comm system just right so that it will reboot and they can manually deploy the test sail. But they'll need to hurry. LightSail will deorbit in 6 months without its solar sail.
Dropbox gets better for business. Everyone wants to be your business's best storage bud, but on Thursday, Dropbox added several features to its enterprise storage offering, Dropbox for Business. Dropbox has added tiered administrative roles, enabling IT teams to grant different people varying permissions. The service now supports team admin, user management, admin, and support admin roles. Service has also introduced an enterprise installer to automate the remote deployment of Dropbox for Business on Windows desktop computers. Dropbox for Business is also gaining support for Active Directory and now boasts ISO 27018 certification, a privacy and data protection standard. The company has also simplified the process of requiring two-step verification to protect user accounts. Now, Dropbox still has a way to go before it's the perfect enterprise storage service, but the new additions take it several steps in the right direction.
Dang! An exploit attacks Macs while they sleep. This attack can leave a permanent backdoor in your Mac and will run when you try to put your machine to sleep. If you have a Mac less than a year old, then this isn't a problem. But apparently older Macs currently still have this vulnerability, and I guess our Macs don't get to go to sleep until Apple fixes this problem.
It may be time to gobble up Wi-Fi companies. In February, HP purchased Aruba Networks for $3 billion to bolster its Wi-Fi portfolio. At the end of May, Fortinet purchased Meru Networks for $44 million. Now some industry pundits are seeing consolidation action in the wireless space and enterprise networking companies who are trying to present a whole package that can rival Cisco at the high end or Ubiquiti on the low end. The same analysts are quick to point out that some integration deals go south, as when Extreme acquired Interesis, but with big independent players like Aerohive and Ruckus still on the market, we may see another major deal before the end of summer.
Maybe your database should take a lesson from cockroaches. Cockroach Labs has announced $6.25 million in funding after a sustained background effort to get CockroachDB established as a widely accepted open source project. CockroachDB is open source code that tries to match the characteristics of Spanner, Google's database system for spanning the globe. Now, many enterprises would adopt Spanner if they could, but it's not open source and it depends on other Google technologies like Colossus, which are not available for external operations. CockroachDB is an attempt to provide a standalone system that has Spanner scalability, survivability, and data integrity. Main goal is to get a distributed database that's highly survivable and maintains precisely synchronized data throughout the system, no matter how broadly it's distributed. CockroachDB, like its namesake, is able to propagate itself without human intervention. If new servers are added to the cluster, it recognizes the fact, propagates data to them, and adds it to its processing operations. If CockroachDB works as planned, it will be a distributed database that's self-mapping and self-balancing. It will also be able to recover from a major loss of hardware without disrupting operations. Now, don't stomp on this one. A cockroach could become your data's best friends if things well and truly hit the fan.
Well, let's add PGP keys to your Facebook profile, but hold the pickles. In an effort to help improve Facebook's security image, they're adding in a cert field to your Facebook profile as an additional place to share your public certificates. Certainly a move in the right direction, but it's going to be a wait and see to make sure they don't flub it like some of their other security efforts.
Hey, IT geeks. It's time to rejoice because Microsoft has brought SSH to Windows. That's right. We're going to party like it's 1985. Long a mainstay of IT geeks, SSH is the de facto way to securely administer your boxes remotely. Sure, there are workarounds and third-party solutions, but it's always been a letdown not to have a native SSH server or client in Windows. Well, now we can stop moping because the PowerShell team has announced that they're going to be working on OpenSSH support in Windows. I want to play with their implementation of SSH before I abandon my trusty copy of PuTTY, and just bringing open SSH functionality to Windows won't make it the console command nirvana of a Nix OS, but this is definitely a move in the right direction. Well, that's it for the blips. Let's go ahead and move on to the bytes, but first, let's welcome back to the show a good friend of This Week in Enterprise Tech. In fact, he was on Twite in the single digits all those years ago. And he's also my co-host for Coding 101, Mr. Lou Maresca, Senior Software Development Lead at Microsoft. Lou, it's so good to have you back on the show.
Great to be back. Thanks for having me.
I think we're going to make this a thing. I always wanted Twite to be sort of a quadrumvirate. What do they call that? A kumquat? I don't know. The four people. This is what we're going to do. Now, Lou, let's go ahead and jump into the bytes because I want to see what kind of... interesting thought you might be able to bring to the conversation. This first one is all about the explosion of infrastructure as a service. Now, Gartner has just released a report that estimates that infrastructure as a service, IaaS, cloud compute, will grow its market by 33% in 2015, up to $16.5 billion with an annual growth rate of 29.1% over the next 4 years. That's still small compared to the estimated $3.5 trillion IT market, but it's still significant. Cheever, let me throw over to you first. When we talk about infrastructure as a service, we're talking about a very specific piece of cloud-enabled computing. This is not everything in the cloud. This is a particular type of service. What is it exactly?
My spin is it's basically metal that you get to go and throw your own servers on. It is a full virtualization system. Let's call it what it is. It's a virtualization platform that hopefully has some cloud-ish features to it. So when you buy into this IaaS platform, you get a pool of resources. That might include CPUs, RAM, disk, so forth, NICs and so forth. So when you say, I want to go and spin up another server, you can go and say, hey, it needs this many CPUs, this much RAM, this much disk. I need a virtual switch and so forth. It allows you to pull from this. Azure has been doing this for quite a while. And this is one of those cases where we're buzzing. IaaS is really, in my mind, more just straight virtualization, but with a few cloud things bolted on.
Actually, that's actually a very good distinction. Let me throw over to you, because this is one of those areas where it gets fuzzy, because there's a lot of blank AAS, something as a service. And this one's infrastructure, but I've also seen, you know, security as a service. I've seen app delivery as a service. I've seen content delivery as a service. And sometimes it's very difficult to make the breakdown lines between them. Do you go along with Cheebert's think of this as bare metal in the cloud?
Yeah, I think that's actually a really good description, because it's the kind of idea where you can split it up and say, you know, I'm going to put just a worker role in the cloud and just serve up some files like a website or something, and that's really just a, you know, a platform application as a service. But in this case, it's you get your own resources that you get to handle and manage, and it makes it feel like your servers are co-located, but you don't own any of the hardware. So that's kind of the key to all that. And I think it makes it, you know, and you don't really know what's really behind the scenes. So most services do today, they say, oh, this is what your hardware is going to be. But, you know, sometimes if it's an Elastic service, you don't really know, but you know that you get some SLA to that product and to that performance for that product. And then you just kind of throw whatever you need on that infrastructure. So that's really kind of the key to infrastructure as a service. It's just an abstraction layer for you to feel like you own the hardware, but you really don't.
Right. Curtis, let me throw over to you and your experience with Information Week Radio. When you talk about infrastructure as a service on the radio to executives who are looking at what kind of buy-in they're going to need, how do they generally feel about it? Do they think that this is going to replace everything they've got in the local colo, everything they've got on campus, or is this sort of segmented out as it's the stuff that we put out there?
You know, it really depends very much on the organization. I've talked to some companies that have gone fully cloud-based for their infrastructure. One of the major telcos that was gobbled up about a year ago, I was talking to them, and they were entirely cloud-based on their back end. They had no data center. They had a couple of small sort of under-desk servers for a couple of particularly sensitive databases, but by and large, everything was in the cloud. So you have that extreme. You have the executives who still hear that cloud isn't safe, and so they want to put nothing on it. And then in between, you have a lot of people who feel that a cloud infrastructure is perfectly acceptable for development work, basically for sandboxing, for doing various experiments and development on, but they're very reluctant to do any production work on it. Now, that's a smaller number with each passing day, because a lot of IT pros are now saying, even if we don't go fully in that direction, there are certain workloads, certain applications that are best served by a cloud infrastructure. So it's really all over the place, depending very much on both the nature of the company and, frankly, the technology savvy of the executives, because there are still a lot of folks afraid of cloud, and then there are that handful who fully embrace it and want to do everything possible out there.
We've got Paula Dean in the chat room who's pointing out that, look, this is all Drupal, which is true. Drupal is really hot right now, and yeah, Drupal will run on a lot of these infrastructure as a service options. But I want to evolve the story now and talk a little bit about how this is growing beyond just the regular players. When we think of infrastructure as a service right now, you probably think about Amazon. You probably think about Microsoft. You may even think a little bit about Google. Google has a few Google for Business offerings, but the market is heating up. In fact, it's going to get really, really hot. Just a few weeks ago, IBM announced that it wants to run with Microsoft and Amazon in this space. They are expanding their OpenStack services so that they can integrate data and services across the hybrid cloud. This is a play for that wonderful nebulous area of hybrid cloud. I want gear on my campus. I want to be able to expand it into the cloud as necessary. I don't want to have to put a big capital outlay. Now, they're not the only ones. Google announced something that I'm really interested in. It's the low priority cloud. Now, this week, Google announced a new tier of Google Cloud Platform compute services that will cost an average of 70% less than the standard Google Compute Engine. Now, the cost reduction comes with a catch. Your processes need to run on spare cycles, which means at any given time, Google can shut them down. Now, Cheever, let me get you in here. We've got a couple of new players coming in. They're not new players in IT, but they're new players in this IaaS area. IBM is taking a different approach. They want IaaS, but they want to leverage all that they've been doing with consulting on local data centers and cloud services. They want to combine the two. Google is saying, okay, we want to give you IaaS, but we want to give you the cheap version. We want to give you the ability to run something persistently in the background that's going to be significantly less than every other player. What's your view on the two?
Okay, so IBM still likes hardware. I've actually been seeing what has been, some people might call IaaS. I've been seeing it from Rackspace for years and years. It's not that new. It's just got a new buzzword. I'm just going to keep reiterating. It's some marketing guys just sitting there in their office buzzing. You know, it works. It's when people want more control, they want to be able to go and use their own licenses. Volume licensing from Microsoft rocks my world. And for a lot of large corporations, it's a lot cheaper to use their licenses, use their volume licensing agreements with Microsoft or whoever, so that they can control the operating systems that are put onto these systems. It's cheaper. You know, you don't have to pay for electricity. You don't have to pay to shore up the floors. You don't have to maintain a data center. You don't have all the HR costs of maintaining the boxes yourself. It's outsourcing on steroids is basically what it is. But so they're trying to take some of the cloud benefits, but they're still a little afraid of the clouds, but they're tired of paying those ginormous bills for their own private data center. This sounds like a very nice compromise. And personally, that's kind of what a lot of universities are leaning towards, because they want to be able to go and run oddball operating systems and special versions of operating systems. And IaaS makes a whole lot of sense for things like that.
Hey, Curtis, we've got JJ to the 4884 talking about Google services, and they're saying, oh, well, this is a business model, right? You give them a trial version of the premium, and then they're going to want to buy more. But my take on Google's we'll run it on our spare cycles business plan is not that. They're already going to get customers who want their premium services, and they are deploying more infrastructure so they can support those customers. But this really sounds like there's always going to be those applications, like data crunching applications, that don't need all the power all the time. They can run on the spare cycles, and they'll process data just fine. Is there a significant enough market in that in the regular enterprise to make something like what Google is offering with the spare CPU cycles plan actually supportable?
Yeah, you know, it's surprising. We tend to think of enterprise apps being a fairly limited universe, but the people that I've talked to who specialize in things like migrating systems or back-end system upgrades point to the fact that the average enterprise has a number of applications that's in the thousands. And in that 1,000-plus application cache, as you say, there are some that just aren't all that time sensitive. Those are absolutely perfect for running on these spare cycles. The real problem with this from a marketing perspective is the same one that we've talked about when we've discussed security issues, when we've said, you know, there are certain bits of data that aren't as important, that aren't as sensitive, and they don't need the same Fort Knox level of security that the truly mission critical stuff does. The hard part is getting someone to admit that their department, their division, their work group is in charge of data that's not as important. In this case, is in charge of an application that isn't as important. You get the ego involved and it gets tricky. But from a realistic standpoint, there's all kinds of apps that can be run on spare cycles and frankly should be run on spare cycles. I think if Amazon can help customers identify those, they've got a really nice market segment set up here.
Yes, yes. Cheebert, I'm going to go off the rails a tiny bit and just say this business plan kind of does remind me of the CompuServe, you know, the start of the internet for us, right? CompuServe was run on spare cycles. That was the whole idea. It was computers used for tax preparation, and they're like, well, we only use this once a year. I wonder what else what we could do with all these cycles. And they started a brand new business plan that, well, we all know very well. Is this the start of something new? Is this Google saying, you know what? There is a lot of unused processing space in the cloud because it has to be so nebulous, because it has so many boxes. I bet this could actually be a pretty big business.
Actually, Kurt and I predicted this in our first book on cloud computing, that as time goes on, people are going to find themselves with spare cycles and they're going to start shopping this around. So say, for instance, I need to run a payroll. You know, payroll has to be run at a certain time, but it doesn't necessarily need to be run on a specific hour, date, or time. It's got some flexibility. So back in the days of service bureaus and minis and mainframes, people would actually shop it or shop their payroll around to different service bureaus and see which one's going to make best use of their spare cycles and give them the best deal on a run. Now with the internet and, you know, various types of infrastructure as a service or software as a service and so forth, and the abstraction we're starting to get with languages, we've got a lot more portability than we had in the old mainframe days. So there really isn't any reason why, you know, my prediction is that we'll start having bots that are going to start shopping around to different services and say, hey, who can give me the best deal on this job? And this job needs to run within 1 or 2 days or 4 or 5 hours of X. And I think that's where we're heading. And that's going to be my prediction for this show.
I love it. Lou, let me get you in here. When you think of a service like Azure or AWS, or even what IBM's trying to cook up, this actually is it, right? I mean, throw away for a second the fact that they're saying it's being used on spare CPU cycles. The whole idea of abstracting this out of the hardware is so that it will run on anything. And if it will run on anything, if it becomes the ultimate Docker container, then spare CPU cycles are all you care about.
That's right. If you think about it, if you're isolating and compartmentalizing the hardware, or the infrastructure, then it really doesn't matter, you know, that you're using spare cycles. It's just whatever the user is going to think that they're going to need, they're going to put out there, and then they're going to get. So, I mean, that's really what it's all about. And I think that the IBM's got a good idea.
Fantastic. All right, let's go ahead and move on to the second Enterprise Byte. This is actually a story that Curtis talked about last week in the Enterprise Blips. Researchers at the Lowe Center for Advanced Security Research Department in Germany, well, they released a report in which they found that more than 56 million sets of unprotected data in cloud databases were essentially open, including those hosted within Amazon Web Services and Facebook's Parse. Now, the issue, they contend, is that cloud databases are designed to make access easy for application developers. That's what they want. They want you to be able to hit the API and do something useful with the data that they're storing. The devs use backend as a service, BaaS, because it means that they don't have to spin up their own iron. And unfortunately, they believe that they can trust the provider to take care of security, which, as Curtis discussed last week, is not necessarily the case. Curtis, let me throw this to you first. This is becoming more and more of an issue because since I don't have to build up my backend, since I don't have to worry about my infrastructure, I put out of sight, out of mind, the fact that they may not be doing the security things they need to do to keep my customers safe.
Well, and remember, this is not so much on the back end. This isn't a back end problem, except that, you know, they allow something to be done. One of the things that we reported on is that all of the big back end service providers give best practices documents, give all sorts of guidance on how to do it right. The problem is that when it comes to the actual coding, the web app developers are the ones who are sitting there and cheaping out on this one piece. You know, they're trying to save themselves what probably amounts to, you know, 100 to 200 lines of code, and simply do something that is going to be very quick, very cheap, very dirty, and very repeatable. It's one of those things that gets back to this whole notion of trust. In their mind, their app is trusted, the back end is trusted, and therefore the security between those two can be pretty relaxed. And what we've seen over and over and over again is that if you relax the security between any two components of a system, some attacker is going to find that and exploit it. And, well, that's what we have here.
The researchers looked at 750,000 apps from both Google Play and the Apple App Store. They analyzed the way that each app addressed APIs. And what they found was that most of them just used a secret key. Yeah, if you could get that key that identified the user, they would let you into the API. They would let you into that back end. And that back end contained thousands of names, addresses, photos, media, basically everything that you might find inside of a back-end as a service server. Lou, let me throw this over to you. This is something that we see more and more, but you are my co-host on Coding 101. And in our demo apps, we show people how to use an API. We show them how to access this information. We've never really showed people how to secure that transfer. And that's right. Now it strikes me as maybe people just don't realize they have to.
Yeah, it's funny that there's a lot of applications out there. I mean, even if you talk about even a lot of the photo applications today, they'll collect like your GPS location even without telling you. And then they'll send it up to their service without securing that even in an SSL or encrypting it. And so, I mean, it's so funny that these applications, they don't think that that's important, but, you know, with tracking today and all these other applications that can track your location, that's actually really important. But yeah, you're right. I mean, nowadays people they want to build an application. Maybe they build it against a public API. And if that public API, you know, like Google's application services or some of these other ones, if they don't secure that pipeline, with OAuth and SSL, then you might run into the fact that you might be leaking data, your customer data even. And then some other services have these non-authenticated endpoints that you pass telemetry data up to, like usability data, where maybe you're clicking on something or where you're going in the app or what you're doing or how long you take, you know, if there's a crash, if there's an error. And sometimes those services will leak customer data. And if it's not secured, you know, that again is a security risk. So, and again, telemetry data is non-authenticated. Sometimes it's not even secure. So these things can leak out, and customers or application developers don't really realize it.
Gentlemen, I want to move on to the third enterprise bite, just because we do have some fun stuff coming up later. I want to give us some time. And actually, I've asked Lou Maresca if he'll stand up three stories that deal with virtual desktops and infrastructure. Lou, do you want to stand up this first one for us? It's all about, we've got new flavors of virtual desktops. What exactly does that mean?
So absolutely. So one of the things that Redmond Magazine pointed out was today traditional desktop, virtual desktops, or allow users to kind of log in anywhere and kind of get the same desktop. And traditionally it's been kind of dominated by Citrix and VMware, where Microsoft's kind of sneaking up behind them. Due to the fact that Hyper-V infrastructure accounts for 1/3 of virtual servers deployed today. And also, bring your own device is also kind of increasing the virtual desktops and more appealing to IT because they can kind of maintain applications on the network and also minimize data loss. So one of the things that they're pointing out, though, is there's something new. So we talked about in the beginning around a new acronym around as a service. And so now what they're saying is developers and companies are moving more towards desktop as a service, meaning that a customer can procure a desktop image in various forms and various services and applications, and they can just pay a monthly fee, and then they can add or delete users on the fly. And it's traditionally it's been kind of an on-premise time thing, but now they're kind of moving it to the cloud. And so one, the couple of them that they pointed out was Citrix, DexGen Workspace, cloud, as well as new VMware Desktop Refresh or Horizon 6. And the Workspace cloud is more kind of focused on application delivery and deployment as more, kind of like infrastructure IaaS, and the VM Horizon 6 is more towards well-suited for 3D graphics and rendering. So it's kind of interesting how they're moving more towards, hey, well, we can do, you know, application infrastructure as a service. Why don't we move everything? Why don't we even move the desktop infrastructure as a service as well?
Achiever, this is something that you've been playing with for quite a while. In fact, the last company that you did consulting with, I don't know what happened to them, but they were trying to do something very much like this. Don't stand anything up on its own. Just pull from your big pool of resources.
Actually, it's gone quite a bit further than that. I can't say who I've been talking to, but I've been talking to a tier one ISP. And right, yes. Shall we say that managed desktops or desktops as a service, which is the new buzzword, is something that we might start seeing, especially as the bandwidth goes up to the home. So now you not only can get triple play, you know, data, video, and voice, but you'll also be able to have a desktop that you can use through your cable set-top box and still be able to access that from your laptop or your tablet anywhere you go. So I could start a big MATLAB simulation at home while I'm still in my PJs, disconnect, come to work, and reconnect, and still have access to that same desktop that still has a big MATLAB simulation running. And now with the fact that server manufacturers are really starting to really pack in the GPU cores, the new Gen 8 HP DL580 that I'm playing with actually has 6 power plugs on the inside, so I can run 6 Tesla boards, you know, 6,000 core or 2,000 core GPUs. And now the server GPUs are coming in different flavors. You can now, within the Citrix world, have actual real GPU compute clusters in addition to 3D rendering. So I guess it's time for a new buzzword, and desktop as a service sounds like a really good one to go with instead of managed desktops.
Oh, Curtis, we've got Paula Dean in the chat room who's saying, oh, by the way, users universally hate this. They don't want desktop as a service. And I understand where this is coming from. Actually, we have a very intelligent chat room. We have a slightly paranoid chat room, and I think many of them don't like the idea of their desktop existing someplace else and them just calling it up when they need it. But what's your take on the readiness for people to accept something like this? I mean, desktop infrastructure as a service is one thing. Desktop as a service is interesting, but it does require you to start thinking very differently about what your PC is.
Oh, no question. And I think the answer to the question of whether people will accept it or even like it or not, so far depends heavily on what they're doing. I mean, if someone is using a desktop machine as a terminal into an application, you know, we can think of everything from the gate agents typing away at the airport to people doing various kinds of point of sale transactions, to people simply doing, say, warehouse or other, you know, control kinds of applications. For them, they have no trouble with the idea of a virtual desktop because all they have ever really seen is the face of an application. What's sitting behind that application is something that they tend to not know and frankly don't care about. Most of the discussion we have tends to be about knowledge workers. Let's face it, people like us and how we see the computer and the desktop. And for knowledge workers, for professionals who do a lot of different things and frankly tend to have a fairly proprietary feeling about the information that they're creating, the virtual desktops have been a much, much harder sell. And there are a lot of reasons for that, but the biggest one has to do with the notion of control, control over the appearance, control over what can be done with applications, control over where the data lives primarily. And it's not until you can get past all of those issues that you can start getting executives and other knowledge workers to begin contemplating the good parts of a virtualized desktop.
Well, let's push on with virtualization. Lou, you're not done with the announcements. Actually, there was a big Hyper-V announcement that was just made. Tell me a little bit about that.
So Hyper-V actually in server Windows Server 2016 is actually supporting what they call nested virtualization with Hyper-V. And what that means is you can actually have a Hyper-V role enabled on Windows Server 2006 VM running on Windows Server 2016 VM. Meaning that what it means basically is in prior to the Server 2016, if you wanted to run Hyper-V VMs, the role actually had to be enabled on a physical deployed server rather than another VM. So this kind of lets you nest kind of going on. If you think about it, that would allow me to run a VM of, let's say, Windows 10 and then run the, you know, mobile VMs that like to test my applications on that VM. And so today you can actually do that, and that will actually allow you to do that. So it's really kind of powerful if you think about it. Again, it's kind of that compartmentalizing infrastructure.
This is sort of like virtualception.
Yes,
I think, right? This is a machine within a machine within, and you can just keep nesting depending on how far you want to go and how many resources you have available. All right, one last bit, and I want you for this. Cisco acquired Piston, and this kind of goes back to the story that we covered in the first Enterprise Byte, this whole idea that you got more and more companies who are really reaching into this infrastructure market. Cisco wants to grow their OpenStack portfolio. What do they get with Piston?
So just as that, exactly that, they get the ability to kind of deploy your VMs and so on and manage them and secure them all, and it's all OpenStack based. And so Cisco clearly has not been putting too much into this effort before. And now they're seeing kind of the value behind it. And they're seeing that there's actually important frameworks on both off-premise and on-premise that comes with OpenStack. And so this is kind of their step into the ring in that case, and similar to what IBM's trying to do. And I think, you know, sooner or later, it's already crowded space. So hopefully Piston will kind of, you know, separate them from the rest.
Fantastic. Well, when we come back, I want to give you one last bit from Interop 2015. That's right. The last thing that we recorded was an interview with the folks over at APC. But before we do that, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech, and it's ZipRecruiter. Now, if you're hiring, if you're looking for people for your business, you understand that those people make your business. They're the ones who are going to come up with the next great idea. They're the ones who are going to have productivity that brings you to the next level. Those are the ones who will make you fail or succeed, which means you need to get quality people. But to get quality people is more than just posting a job listing here or there. You need to use someone who can get your job listing everywhere so you can get the right person. And that's what ZipRecruiter does. ZipRecruiter understands that posting your job in one place is enough to find that quality candidate. So they let you post once and get placed on over 100 job sites. And you get instantly matched candidates from over 4 million resumes. Just post once, and within 24 hours, you can watch those qualified candidates roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface, letting you make the right decisions about hiring in the least amount of time. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by over 400,000 businesses. They use it. You probably should, too. Now, you can try ZipRecruiter today with a free 4-day trial and get your perfect candidate before they go to somebody else by going to ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. That's ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Let's take one last trip over to my favorite conference of the year, Interop. I was there with both Brian and Chiebert, and we stopped by to get some power from APC. I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the Digital Jesuit, with This Week in Enterprise Tech on the TWiT TV network. I'm standing next to Surgeon Matabja from APC, who's going to explain what they're releasing at the show. Surgeon, thank you very much for talking to me. What is this?
Hello, this is a industry-leading SmartUps battery backup solution, which pretty much is the base of your physical infrastructure that protects all your servers, networks, storage, and everything else. People in IT industry sometimes don't think about these pieces, but this is what you need to run your IT infrastructure, whatever that is. So today we are presenting just a new generation of the SmartUps Online products. It's an industry-leading efficiency, industry-leading power factor, industry-leading features, which means in addition to protecting your IT equipment and as we like to call it, legendary reliability, it also will help you save the energy, help you save your energy costs, and in the long run, it will also tell you when it's something wrong with it, then you need to replace the battery, or what else you need to do with the equipment.
Surgeon, I know my audience pretty well, and even though they're experienced, even though they're very good IT managers, for many of them, power protection is one of the last things they consider because it's just not... it's not sexy, right? It either sits in a rack or it sits at the bottom of the rack, and it's almost an afterthought after they design their network. For one of those folk who may have been doing this for years and years, why? Why would they replace what they have? I mean, what would be the selling point, the secret sauce that you can offer to say, this is time to upgrade?
Because you really don't need to think about these pieces. We already thought about it for you. We work with all the IT industry leading providers and equipment Cisco's, HP's, and all those guys. So we have developed solutions that have been pre-engineered, pre-validated, and work with these solutions fully and have been optimized for your installations. On another level, our software is the piece that connects our equipment with their equipment, so you can get information about our equipment through their software, and so you don't need to buy another piece of solution that's going to help you see the real picture. For example, you can see the energy usage of your outlets over your batteries or SmartUps through the Cisco switches. So it's already figured out for you. Just look, find out the information available on these sites, on our site or IT guy sites, and it's already there.
All right, now let's give them some tech porn here. Give me the specs. How much capacity, what kind of management can I expect out of each of these models, and pricing and availability?
We have the SmartUps online range from 1 kilowatts all the way to 20 kilowatts. So usually in one rack, you have about 3, 4. If you're really good at it, 5. If you're really good at it, 6. So this one unit can pretty much take care of up to 4 or 5 racks of your solutions. And the runtime on the full load is about 5 minutes, which is pretty much what you need, because our software will send you the message saying you ran out of power, so you can move your virtual machines or whatever else to other location. And pricing varies on the model of the runtime, but definitely ranges from $1,000 all the way up to $5,000-$10,000.
Surgeon, thank you very much. Now, if they wanted to find out more about APC, about your solutions, where do they go?
Please go to apc.com. You're going to have all the detailed technical information about these products. You're going to be able to find the list of distributors for our products and anything else you need, how we're working well with our IT partners.
Both Cheebert and I are APC guys from way back, but we spent most of our time dealing with enterprise APC gear, which is actually quite different from their consumer level stuff. Cheebert, are you still an APC shop over there?
Yeah, actually, one of the big reasons why we're on the infrastructure series, ISX, is because there's a lot of user serviceable pieces in there. The power modules are actually a one-man lift, and they're by 10 and 20 kilowatt slices. So we can actually start off with a larger chassis, and as the data center needs grow, we can actually slide more slices in. I'm actually running an N plus 2 configuration because some of my tests run so long, but N plus 1 has been great. And the in-row air conditioning systems have been spectacular. And because they talk to each other, they actually even out the hotspots in my data center. And we're kind of cheap. We actually, the battery packs are just galvanized steel. We pop them out, we open them up, and we actually replace the cells inside them so we can dramatically reduce our maintenance costs.
Oh, I gotta say, the chat room is cracking me up right now because I forgot that your choice of UPS is actually kind of a religious thing for a lot of these geeks. I mean, again, I'm a geek. Some people love APC. Some people hate APC. Some people are saying just go with Triplite. Chat room, I love you. Just remember, it's okay. Whatever you choose, I'm down with it. We're, in fact, all four of us. Could we get the quad screen here, the kumquat? We're all okay with whatever UPS you decide to use. Unless, of course, it's Triplite, because then you're just stupid. You're just really stupid. No, okay. Let's step out of that, because we wanted to do something a little bit fun. Now, we have been, of course, heading into summer. And now, in this second week of June, we are definitely in summer. And a lot of kids are going on vacation. A lot of people who are professionals are heading out. And so we thought we should do one of these roundups where we go around the table and we ask all of the experts, all of our panelists, all of our co-hosts and guests, what kind of gear would you take with you as you head out? If you are a professional, a networking person, what would you want in your bag of tricks as you head out of the office? Cheebert, I want to throw to you first. What would you think people need to have as they get on that jet plane?
Well, I just got my little kit from Bondic. They call it a plastic welder. And it's not that much different from what I used to use for UV curable fiber optics, but this is awesome. It's in a little squeeze pan. It's got a ball valve on it so it doesn't dry out. So you can actually just squeeze it on and then flip it around with that little UV flashlight, and it cures in seconds. And it's super strong. If you go through, there's tons and tons of different little videos on how to do it. We actually tried it on the back cover on a garage clicker, and it just fixed it right up. It's awesome. And they do sell refills in a pen format. Now, it's a nice needle tip. Really, really nice system. I love super glue. Don't get me wrong. Super glue is great. But this system, because I can cure it, I can squeeze it on, I have a lot of working time, and then I hit it with the UV light, and now all of a sudden, it cures. So I've got lots more working time so I can move things around and get it just right. So you see that little UV light going
there. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, and it's not expensive. I bought mine off Amazon. I think it was like $14 for the starter set. Not horrible.
Nice. Now, actually, JJ to the 4884 has a good question. Is that going to get confiscated by the TSA as you try to go on board?
Well, it's under 3 ounces.
They should it, right?
I don't know. You know, I have no idea. According to the rules I've seen, it shouldn't be confiscated. But that's now going to be part of my normal travel kit, because I can't tell you how many things I've managed to break, and I'm just not someplace where I can get a replacement.
And if you don't need to fix something, which, by the way, Cheebert, very practical suggestion. Thank you very much. You could always use the UV light as like a rave thing. Yeah. Let's go to my first pick. I finally got this in the mail. This is my IDIS Networks Shield. This is the thing that we've been talking about on the show. We had Daniel Ayoub on because he's the one who actually kickstarted this, made a lot of people very happy to include enterprise-level hardware and enterprise-level programming into a box that's, this is kind of a tough box to open, that's that big. So this is the device itself. What I'm going to be doing over the next couple of weeks is I want to stress this thing out. I want to say, I got to talk to Daniel about, my goodness, it shouldn't be, okay. Whew. That was kind of tarp. All right, now this, because it's basically just a Linux computer that has a bunch of security modules built into it, what I want to do is I want to build all of my VPN settings into this. So it will tunnel back to my network here in San Francisco just by plugging it in. And that should be completely and totally possible. And because it's using the Cavium processors in here, it will be able to handle that. It will be able to handle all my security. It will even be able to act as a network tap when I need it. Now, again, what was the website for this? I think it was itisnetworks.com. The Kickstarter is over, obviously, because they're delivering it. It was a little bit late, but he did get it to us. And Chiebert, you've got one of these too, right?
I've got an alpha version.
You got one of the 3D printed versions.
Yeah. The production versions are supposedly on their way. I bought three of them.
Okay. All right. You know what we should do? I should see if I could just get one of these for each of the Twiet hosts, and we'll just use this as our way to get back into the brick house.
Well, actually, for Lou too.
Yeah. I see that face there, Lou. For a second, Lou was like,
"Great." Yeah. Mine are going to be used for relatives that are constantly getting hacked. It's like, no, I want to stop having to go do house calls.
Right. And remember, this has the dumb simple mode where basically you just plug it in and it handles everything in the background. And then it has expert mode, which lets you drop on packages. Like, for example, if you want to run Wireshark on this and let it do its packet analysis, you could actually do that in the box. I can't stress how much fun I'm going to have with this over the next couple of weeks. Curtis, what's your first call?
Well, for most of us, when we leave our offices and go off to do fun things, we're going to want to bring back some memories. And that's why I chose the Olympus TG3 as my first choice. This is one of those cameras that fits into the pocket of your board shorts. It will shoot essentially from anywhere. It is tough. It is waterproof. It is dustproof. It is shockproof. You can drop it in the ocean, drop it down the stairs. And it is good image quality. So this is a great, great camera to take with you. If you want to have something that's a better image quality than the average smartphone, but that isn't so delicate that you have to worry about it.
Nice. Now, I wouldn't normally think of carrying a camera because I carry my phone with me, but I guess, yeah, if it's summer, it's a special time. You want something that's a bit nicer than what you can get off of the built-in sensor.
And two, you know, let's realize there are times when you might be out in the great out of doors when you don't want to carry your phone because it's delicate. The nice thing about this is you can leave your phone behind, stuff this in your pocket, and even if you go swimming, do whatever you're going to do out in the great out of doors, you don't have to worry about it. Your phone is safe and sound, and you're able to get all the photos you want with this thing.
Let's go on to you, Lou. What's your first call? And hopefully it's something that will help me stay connected while I'm away for the summer.
Yeah, so mine's a simple pick. It's actually an application. It's called Android Foxfy. And a lot of people probably heard of it. It's a pretty old application. But it basically allows you to tether or create a Wi-Fi hotspot without really too much trouble. It's just a check of a box and boom, you got it ready to go. And you don't necessarily have to have, now here's kind of the caveat, you don't necessarily have to have the tethering plans for some of the services out there, whether it's AT&T or Verizon. But again, and they will at some point, if you use too much data, they will shut you down. But at this point, you know, this is for easy if you're in a hotel that charges too much or you just want to use it to get your email or something like that, you can turn it on and boom, your laptop or your tablet can connect to it and you have instant internet access.
It's great if you need access in a spot. Oh, and by the way, quick tip. If you are on a service provider, T-Mobile, AT&T, that will look at your traffic and then determine that it's not coming from a phone and then send you a warning message saying you must buy a tethering program or plan, what you can do is actually install on your laptop ProXPN or any other free VPN service, because if the traffic is encrypted, they can't check it and they won't know it's not coming from your phone. Chiebert, back to you. What's your second choice for the executive summer?
Well, I'm sorry. I've got flat feet. And the unfortunate fact of life is if I'm going to do a lot of walking, which you tend to do on your vacation, I don't always have a handy-dandy masseuse. So I actually travel with this little roller. And if we could go to that picture, all it is something really simple. TSA doesn't even think it's a club. So I've never had trouble with it going in. They come in lots of different styles. I use a wooden one, but they also have plastic ones and so forth. Just roll your feet on it. And it, you know, you kind of feel that little bit of crunching as it kind of moves the your foot around. But the idea is it stretches the plantar fasciitis, it stretches the tendons, and I love it. You know, it has saved my feet at many a trade show, and it has saved my feet as I'm walking around.
Wait, what were you actually trying to say there, Chief Bird?
Never mind. Okay. Love it, love it, love it.
You know, it's interesting because we're bringing a lot of techie stuff, and you're bringing the actual, like, I would want that on my trip. I would want something to fix the thing I'm eventually going to break, and I would want something to relax my feet. All right, I've got another techie thing that I would bring with me. And this is more for the folk who are going to be going into places where maybe you don't want to have your primary device, or maybe you're one of these people who are ultra paranoid and you're looking for something in a burner phone. You don't want to use a $400, $500, $600, $800 phone for a burner. But what about a $100 Android phone? That's what this is. This is the NU3S, the new phone. Now, this is a cheap Android phone. It's $130. It's decent. We actually did a review of this on Before You Buy. But what really makes it interesting is that first, it's a world phone. Secondly, if you look at my product camera, Brian, this has, oh, there we go. It has two SIM slots. So you could have multiple SIMs in here. Especially if you're traveling internationally and you want to be able to make local calls, you want to be able to have, say, your T-Mobile SIM, which works out of the country. This is a really cool way to combine the best parts of multiple plans. And this also has, actually, this is not documented, but this does have a way to switch the IMEI number if you really want the ultimate in burner phones. So again, not a super great Android phone, not a bad Android phone. I mean, it's nice. It's got a big screen. It actually looks good. It's got a very long battery life. But what I would use it for is if I want a disposable phone, I want something that it's not really going to be tied back to me, and I want something that will work across the planet with multiple SIMs. This, again, is the NU3S unlocked Android smartphone. All right, let's go over to you, Curtis. What's your second call?
Well, my second call is a way to keep up with where you are and what you're doing. Hold on to that information, even if you are far away from places where your phone is going to work for such things. The Suunto Ambit 3 is what I'm going to recommend. You know, this is a GPS watch that can help you plan your off-road adventures. It can help you keep up with your progress. It can do all kinds of things. Keep track of altitude. You can get versions that have swimming and water functions. You can use it to control your cameras and do various other things. They're very, very neat. They are not super cheap. But again, if you're the kind of person who occasionally needs to go places and do things where your phone isn't the best thing to carry with you, then something like this is wonderful. Now, I have a similar device from Timex that works really well. It is my constant companion when I'm out of the office, and I find that it really does help me keep track of what I'm doing. It doesn't try to replace my phone, but at times when my phone is just not handy to have with me, it keeps doing what it needs to. So highly recommended if you're doing stuff this summer where you're kind of unplugging but just want to keep track of where you're going and where you've been.
Two straight recommendations for products to help you stay connected. Gee, Lou, I would really like for us to have a third.
So I kind of stole this a little bit from your pick only because I thought, well, you have an unlocked phone, but how are you going to make calls when you're abroad? So the idea here is, you know, global prepaid SIM cards. And so the key here is some of these services like OneSIM will have almost 200 different countries that you can get access to where you don't have to change your SIM card out, keep the same phone number. It gives you the ability to, if you're traveling, you know, in Europe or Asia, it allows you to actually use the same phone number wherever you go. And doesn't, you don't have to worry about, you know, popping open the phone and switching to a different SIM card, trying to find a SIM seller, using your passport to get one, that kind of thing. This kind of gets rid of all that hassle. And so, and I usually take one of these along with me wherever I go. And they have data plans, they have, you know, calling plans, that kind of thing.
It's funny that most of the world is used to being able to swap out SIM cards. Our top three cell phone carriers, that really only became a possibility in the last couple of years. Go figure. Let's go back up to the top. Chiebert, give us your third and final pick.
Well, this little doodad doesn't look like a whole lot of anything. It's about the size of a lipstick tube. So guys, go and check your wife's purse. It's about the size of that. And it's weird. It's a Wi-Fi router. It doesn't have a huge amount of power, but it's meant for something like a hotel room. Now, the interesting thing is it's also a USB wired Ethernet adapter, or you could actually take a Ethernet coming from your hotel room and just put it on a USB power supply or battery pack, and it becomes a router, or it can be a Wi-Fi bridge. All of it's settable through software, and it's not really expensive. So if we can go to the picture, it's kind of nice. Yes, JJ to the 4884. It's actually not. Oh, that's the wrong one.
That's what's in the dock.
I'm sorry. That's definitely not the one. Try. Oh, shucks.
Are you trying to bamboozle the Twiat, right?
No, I'm being bad. I thought I got the right one. That was the second one I stuck in. Anyway, this guy is. The USB cable actually tucks right into the unit itself. It's called, there it is, middle line there. So the USB tucks in and the Ethernet's on the other side. Now, I will say it doesn't work that well on a Mac, but on a Windows machine, it's awesome. And unfortunately, the software is not available for Linux. I think there's some hacks on how to do it anyway. But it actually is not a bad USB Ethernet adapter, and it's been fairly decent as a Wi-Fi adapter.
Nice.
Not horrible. Uses almost no power.
No, but it's nice to have, and nice and small, and it pretty much does everything we want it to do.
Yeah, pretty much.
I've got something like that, but a lot bigger and more complicated and way, way more expensive. This right here is the ATT ZTE S Pro 2. Now, it's a hotspot, but it's also a battery bank, and it's also a projector, which is kind of cool. Oh, and by the way, it's also an Android device. So if you've ever wanted to have Android on your projector for some reason, you could do it with this. I reviewed the very first version of this on Sprint. They called it the Sprint Spark Pro. It was not great. It was just good enough in all of its categories to be disappointing. But this one is supposed to be a lot better. This is the second version. They've much improved the interface. They've actually improved the battery life. The projector is a lot brighter. And from what I can tell, the hotspot actually works. Now, of course, this is only going to work if you're traveling in the United States. If you're going international, this is not going to help you whole much. And you are bound by AT&T's plans. And this particular one is bound to 5 gigabytes. If I use that up, I'm done. But it is like Chiebert's device. It is something that you could carry with you, and you'd always stay connected. You'd always have a device that's ready to go, and you'd always have a device that's ready to power up your other devices. And if you've got kids, this is a great way to let them watch what they want to watch, even when you don't have access to, say, an HDMI screen. So that, again, that's the ATT ZTE S Pro 2. Curtis, give us your last one.
Well, my last two suggestions have been really useful for people who are heading off the grid for their vacation. And if you're going to do that, then there are some safety things you need to keep in mind. My next choice is in Kickstarter mode. And to be brutally honest, it's not doing terribly well right now, but it should be, because it helps you get to do something that you really should do anytime you go off the beaten path, and that is let your friends and or family know your plan. And in this case, what it does is that it helps you. You map out your plan in the app, give it a couple of waypoints, and then give it three contacts. And what it does, if within a reasonable time of when you were supposed to be back at your ending point or at a point you designate, you haven't made it, it will automatically send from its servers a message to those three contacts saying, hey, Kurt hasn't shown up. Try to get in touch with him. And then it gets ever more insistent as time goes by. If you don't file, basically, if you don't shut it off by getting to your point. And by doing this, it means that it's much less likely that you're going to have one of these situations where you fall down a hole somewhere and it's 2 weeks before anyone notices that you're gone. That's sort of a worst case scenario. We like to avoid worst case scenarios. And this is a relatively inexpensive and simple way to do just that.
So if you're an outdoorsman and you're worried about falling into a crevice between boulders and having to gnaw off your own arm, this might be a responsible way to go. Hey, Lou, I don't like responsibility. I like gadgets. So give me a gadget for your final pick.
So again, I chose a little bit more simplistic, but you know, one thing I notice when I travel around and I go to hotel rooms or conferences and I want to use a hard line, especially even do shows like this, I never get enough network ports for all the devices I have. And so the concept here is just portable network switch, you know, something small, it'll fit really tiny, gives you additional ports. It's gigabit speed. It's real light, only a couple ounces, and it will fit in your bag. And so that's kind of the key. This will actually help you expand on your devices and have your kind of your portable station that you want to work at.
Nice, nice and simple, and always, always useful. Well, gentlemen, congratulations. We've made it to the end of our summer list. We got to do this more often. I like doing segments like this where we could sort of show the folks in the Twilight Riot, the geeks, the geeky gadgets that we've been playing with. Thank you very much for being part of it. I do want to thank you all for using up another hour listening to the best dang enterprise podcast in the world. That's according to 9 out of 10 technical directors. I want to thank all of my panelists for being here and being part of the show. Let's start with Lou. Lou Maresca, my co-host for Coding 101, now a stalwart here at the Twit TV network. Where can people find you and your work?
Well, you can always find me on Twitter at LouMM. And also all of my work that I do at Microsoft is found at crm.dynamics.com.
Follow them, find them, watch them on Coding 101. Lou, always a pleasure. We'll see you next time. Of course, I want to thank my co-hosts. And again, let's start with Curtis Franklin because, well, he's just sexy. Curtis, could you please tell the folks where they could find you if they want to see your work, if they want to listen to your radio show, if they want to read the articles that you've been writing, where do they find you?
Well, pretty much everything that I write can be found at informationweek.com. Just look for my smiling face there on the homepage, or you can follow me on Twitter at KG4GWA. I try to let folks know when new words of wisdom roll off my keyboard.
And last but not least, Chiebert. Chiebert, my good friend, what is the Geek in Paradise going to be up to over the next week or so?
Well, I am 3D printing my heart out. My 3D printer actually has been printing almost nonstop for the last 4 weeks now. And I've got the Hawaii Space Flight Lab. I've got actually someone from the Planetary Sciences is having me print a mirror holder for a 3-meter telescope. Woohoo! And I've got a whole bunch of battery holders for the Hawaii Natural Energy Institute. And if all goes well, I'm going to be 3D printing parts for a baby cabled observatory that's going to go into a pond so that the University of Hawaii students have a cabled observatory that they can just walk to and practice being full-scale oceanographers.
You always get the most interesting side projects. Again, thank you so very much, gentlemen. It's always a pleasure to do This Week in Enterprise Tech with you. You make it fun, you make it enjoyable, and you make it entertaining. I also want to thank you. That's right, the person who listens to, who downloads our show each and every single week. If we didn't have such a large, loyal audience, we wouldn't be able to do what we love. And so we want to make it easier for you to get This Week in Enterprise Tech. Just go to our show page at twit.tv/twiet, T-W-I-E-T. You'll be able to find all of our back episodes along with the links of the stories that we covered in those episodes. And you'll also be able to subscribe. That's right. If you go up to the upper left-hand corner, you'll find a little drop-down menu that lets you get the version of choice into your device of choice. If you want to get the audio version on your iPhone, maybe you want to get the video version on your Android tablet. Maybe you want the high-definition video version on your Mac, your PC, your laptop, your desktop. Whatever it is and whatever your pleasure is, we'll find it for you because, well, we love you. Don't forget that we do this show live most Fridays at 1 o'clock p.m. Pacific time. Just go to live.twit.tv and you'll be able to find us before, during, and after the show. And as long as you're going to watch live, why not interact with us by going to our chat room at irc.twit.tv. There will be something there for you to mention to us what you want to see, questions you have about the information that we're covering, and maybe just hang out with the host. Lastly, I want to thank everyone who makes this show possible. Of course, to Lisa and to Leo, to Karsten, my super producer, and to my TD today, who is normally Zach, but it's this guy who used to be my TD, but he abandoned me when he became a big deal. Mr. Brian Burnett. So, Brian, I mean, you're not normally part of Twit anymore because you've forsaken us, but where else can they find you on the Twit TV network?
Everything you have just said is absolutely true. Yeah. you can find me doing know-how on Thursdays with you. We've always got some crazy projects going up. And I also wanted to say hi to Lou because I don't get to work with him anymore either. Because I have also forsaken Coding 101.
Brian, I got a question. When are you going to stop being my co-host on Know How? Because I just figure you're going to abandon me there as well, right?
Well, I think it'll probably be after I stop feeling like this. I think me and you are kind of running out of steam.
I ran out of steam about three shows ago. Thanks, Brian. It's always a pleasure to have you. Folks, I'm Father Robert Ballecer. This has been This Week in Enterprise Tech. And just remember, if you want to know what's going on in the enterprise, just keep quiet.